Let us worship Jesus.
Come, let us worship Jesus, King of nations, Lord of all. Magnificent and glorious, just and merciful.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Hope Community Church here in Biddenden. It's great to see you all, and welcome, of course, to everyone who's streaming or watching online as well. So to start off this morning, Beth is going to lead us in prayer.
Dear Lord, we thank you for being able to freely meet together this morning. May your blessing be upon us as we worship you today. We ask that you open our hearts, our minds, and connect us individually and as a church family today. Amen.
And our first song we're going to sing this morning is Creation Sings. If we can stand, please.
Creation sings the Father's song. He calls the sun to wake the dawn. And on the course of day, till evening falls in crimson gray. Fingerprints in flakes of snow, his breath upon the spinning gold. He charts the eagle's flight, commands the newborn baby's cry. Tell the wonders of creation.
Thank you. Now, Josh and I weren't here last week, so for us, this is the first time that we have heard you all sing. Just got a bit emotional because obviously it's coming up to our last Sundays. But so it was really great to hear you all sing. I'm just going to read out some notices. One of the main things is that there is a Life magazine out at the front of the church, so please take one of those and read it for yourselves. There's some really encouraging things in there, and then take it away and pass it on to a neighbour who may also be encouraged by that. Another notice that we've got is there's the book aid. So if you have any Christian books that you have got that you might be having a clear out, if you can give them to Hillary before the 15th of August, then these books are going to go to Africa, where some people don't have any access to books, or they're not in good quality. So if you can look at, if you go on the, in the notice sheet that you've got, there's a link which you can check which can be used and what can't. Okay, so if we can do that by the 15th of August, that would be great. Now the next song that we're gonna sing is called I Am Who You Say I Am. And this is one of our personal favorites. It's by Hillsong. It might be a fairly new one to you, but it would be great if we can all stand and sing. Thank you.
Who am I that the highest king would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son. I am.
Okay, so we've got a poem that we want to share with you now. I didn't write it, don't worry. It's called Footprints in the Sand. Most of you probably have heard it at some point, but we find it a really encouraging message poem to, you know, encourage us when times are a bit difficult, and you know, we're aware there's various problems going on, lots of people having difficult times, so we hope maybe you might take some encouragement from this as well. So. And it sort of reminds us that God is always there carrying us through our difficult times. One night, I dreamed a dream. As I was walking along the beach with my Lord, across the dark sky flashed scenes from my life. For each scene, I noticed two sets of footprints in the sand, one belonging to me and one to my Lord. After the scene of my life flashed before me, I looked back at the footprints in the sand. I noticed that at many times, along the path of my life, especially at the very lowest and saddest times, there was only one set of footprints.
This really troubled me, so I asked the Lord about it. Lord, you said that once I follow you, you'd walk with me all the way. But I noticed that during the saddest and most troublesome times of my life, there was only one set of footprints. I don't understand why, when I needed you the most, you would leave me. And he whispered, "My precious child, I love you and I will never leave you, never ever during your trials and testings. And when you saw only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you." And so, yeah, just like Josh said, we are aware that there's a lot of hurt in people, especially in this church. And we just hope that is encouraging, that during those troubled times, you might think you're on your own, but actually, if you look back, God is carrying you and you aren't on your own. And also, as a fellowship, we're all here together. Now, the next part is our children's slot, which has been recommended by Rafi. So if you don't like it, you can blame him. Now, again, this is one of Rafi's favourite videos, and we just love the words of it. It's a beautiful song. And kids, if you want to get up and dance, and adults too, there is no limit on dancing, then please feel free to do so. You can stand during this, or you can sit. You can do however you feel more comfortable. But so let's watch this children's video, and it's called Deep Cries Out. And after this video, the children will be going out to their groups.
Okay, so as Beth said, the children can all leave now, please. Thank you. And now that they've gone, we'll bow our heads in prayer, please. Dear Lord, we thank you for the blessings you have bestowed upon Hope Church, and we ask that you continue to do so. We particularly thank you, Lord, for calling Dave Stone to be our pastor. We pray for Dave and his family as they move to the area. We ask that you help them to settle in comfortably and quickly. We pray for all of those in our community who are experiencing suffering and hardship. Help us to remember that, as we heard earlier this morning, you are with us to carry us through all of our struggles. And help us to remember to lean on you and to commit our lives fully to you, Lord. Finally, Lord, we pray for Peter as he comes to deliver the word to us this morning. And we ask that your Spirit speaks clearly through him and reaches our hearts. Amen. Right, we're going to have our reading now, which is from the book of Philippians. It is chapter 1, verses 18 to 30. And in the Church Blue Bible, that is page 1178. So the important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and God's provision of the Holy Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. But it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain, and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you, again, your boasting in Christ will abound on account of me. Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in the one Spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel, without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. This is a sign to them that they will be destroyed, but that you will be saved, and that by God. For it has been granted to you on behalf of Christ not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him, since you are going through the same struggle you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. So hand over now, after the song, to Peter. And the song we're going to sing firstly is I Will Sing of the Lamb. If we can stand, please.
Sing of the Lamb, of the price that was paid for me, purchased by God, giving all he could give. Here now I stand in the garments of righteousness. Death has no hold, for in Jesus I live. To the man who gave everything, humbling himself before all he had made. Dare I withhold my own life from his sovereignty? I shall give all for the sake of his name. Oh, I will sing of the
Good morning, everyone. It's don't be too enthusiastic, will you? But it's great to be together. And we open our Bibles again to the letter of Paul to the Philippians. And if you have a church Bible, it's 1178, page 1178. I had a pastor who used to warn other preachers, including myself, to just beware that you don't always get attracted as a preacher to what we call the purple passages in the Bible, or the purple verses. And what he meant was those verses or passages that everybody knows, you know, the big themes, and that the sort of thing that to a preacher looks relatively easy to preach because everyone knows the passage and everyone knows what it means. And so his idea was, you know, you don't really need to do that. It's not a good idea. And in fact, I think we avoid it at Hope Community Church because what we tend to do is to work through books of the Bible. So we went through, very dangerously, the whole book of Revelation, which I found thrilling and inspiring myself. And we looked very closely at the Lord's Prayer. We've done the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 5 and to chapter 7. And we hope to continue through Matthew for a while. So we try to keep to big passages and work through the passages and the books of the Bible. That way, from a preaching point of view, you can't miss out the difficult bits. You have to tackle them whether you want to or not. And you see them looming up, you know. When you actually set out the pattern of who is preaching, you always have a quick look to see which one you've managed to put yourself in and whether that was a good idea after all. So, the purple passages. Well, we actually have a purple passage this morning which we can't avoid and we don't want to. And it's verse 21 in the chapter 1 of Philippians, which is, "For to me, to live is Christ and to die is gain." I doubt whether if you are a Bible-believing Christian that you don't know that verse. "For me, to live is Christ and to die is gain." It's an inspiring passage, isn't it? An inspiring verse. But we're going to just unpack it a little bit through the passage that we read earlier on. So we're going to look, first of all, living for Christ. Living for Christ. And Paul really talks about that in this passage very clearly. A friend of mine, well, in fact, myself, I was in a church where the preacher was preaching and he said, "Well, you know, being a Christian is going uphill." And we thought, well, that's true. But then he sort of spoiled it by saying, "Well, it's going uphill, but it's in a Rolls Royce." And I thought, well, I think I know what he means, but I'm not sure it's the sort of illustration I would make. Perhaps the Apostle Paul, would he have made the illustration, yeah, being a Christian is going uphill, but in a golden chariot produced by Mercedes. Is that what Paul would say? I don't think so. That isn't really what going uphill as a Christian is about. In fact, we read, didn't we, just a week ago, that the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 speaks there of his trials as a Christian and as an evangelist and as an apostle, and the tremendous ordeals that he went through just as a matter of course because he loved the Lord Jesus. And the passage we're in today reminds us again that Paul is in prison, and he's in prison for Christ. So he is under house arrest, he's got soldiers who he's chained to day and night, and he is facing trial, and he is facing possible death for the Lord Jesus. And so he begins this passage that we read, "Yes, and I will continue to rejoice. For I know that through your prayers and God's provision of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage so that now as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For me to live is Christ and to die is gain." Paul is in crisis. Just those two verses or so reminds us of the crisis of this man's life. And yet, what we read is, "Yes, and I will continue to rejoice." In fact, joy, the word, and rejoice, the word, appears something like 12 times in this letter alone. It's so frequent that a lot of commentators seem to home in on it, and their whole commentary is based on Paul's joy and rejoicing. Now, the question we have to ask ourselves, is Paul just putting a brave face on a very disastrous situation? Is he doing what we Brits call the stiff upper lip, not giving in to this terrible ordeal that he is going through and is about to face? That is the question for him. Is that the sort of man that he is? And the answer, of course, and it's on all our lips, is that no, that is not what kind of man he is. He is not just putting a brave face on it. He is a man full of joy and is rejoicing, as he correctly says. Why? How can he do that? And the answer is because of the prayers of the Philippian Christians and of others. Did you notice that? I know that through your prayers and God's provision of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. Through your prayers. Paul is a praying man. We know that the first part of our passage that we read a couple of weeks ago. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy. There's that word again. Because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. I remember you in my prayers. Paul was a praying man. He prayed continually for these churches that he loved so deeply. But here's the thing. Here's this indefatigable Paul, you know, this great apostle, a man of immense courage and work and hardship, knowing that he needs the prayers of others for himself. He needs the partnership of the Philippians, who, as it were, are praying as though they're in prison with Paul, and they're praying for him. And that means so much to him. In fact, because of their prayers, there is the supply of the Holy Spirit himself who comes to Paul's defense. He knows that they are going to pray, and therefore I know through your prayers and God's provision of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. And so immediately he knows that that provision of the importance of the Spirit of God in his heart is partly because of the prayers of the Philippian Christians. And he goes on that through that Spirit, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. It is giving him confidence for the future. It's an interesting word, that word deliverance, and no one really knows what he's getting at. Is he just thinking that God is going to make sure that he is acquitted when he stands before the emperor? It's unlikely that he means that. The word has got two or three meanings to it, and in fact, the margin in your Bible will show you that. It's more probably that he's thinking, well, whatever happens, my salvation is assured. I know I will be delivered into the hands of the Lord Jesus, whatever the emperor decides. And then he goes on, I eagerly expect and hope that I will no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage so that now as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. In other words, he knows by the prayers of the people in Philippians and the gift of the Holy Spirit in his life that whatever happens as he stands before that emperor, that he will have courage and he will know that he can stand there with courage and be assured of whatever the outcome, the Lord Jesus is going to be honored. That is the prayers of the saints, the prayers of God's people for this apostle. And that just brings it home to us, doesn't it? The importance of our prayer for each other. Paul, this apostle, living for Christ meant he could live for Christ because of the prayers of God's people for him. The great Spurgeon of the 19th century preacher was asked, and I've mentioned this before, what is the secret of your tremendous gift and your tremendous success in bringing people to Christ and having this building this wonderful church? And his answer was instant. My people pray for me. That was his answer. And that is the challenge to you and me. That's why in our notice sheet, which I hope either you download or you took it this morning, we have on the back of that sheet those who need particular prayer, people who are specifically in need of all sorts and are willing just to state that, then we pray for them in their particular need. But we have our daily prayers, don't we? I hope you've noticed that each day a member of this church, those who attend this church, are named each day differently. Why? So that every one of us is prayed for on a regular basis. I hope you take that opportunity and don't let it pass. We need your prayers. We need each other to pray for each other. Do you pray for the leaders of this church? I know that's sort of self-pleading in a way. But how important is that? You know, sometimes when we preach, you know, we're in the middle of our preaching or even definitely at the end, and we say, well, that was a bit of a stinker, wasn't it? You know, we could have done so much better there. And the trouble is, you know, your congregation are thinking the same thing. In fact, they thought it before you did. And I understand that. But I want to throw that back at you and say, listen, when you leave a church and you've heard the preaching and you say, well, I don't know what that was about. It didn't really, you know, I thought it was a bit poor this morning. He wasn't on form. Have you asked yourself how much you prayed for the preacher? How much have you really opened your heart to what is going to be heard this morning, for instance? And have you prayed for the preacher? We get the preachers that we deserve, don't we? And therefore, if we pray for each other and we pray for our leaders and we pray for our preachers, then God will answer the prayer as he did for Paul and supply the Holy Spirit to come and energize us and help us to understand and to act on what we hear. And so we've already prayed for Dave Stone and his wife, Becca, and the children who will be coming to us in the not too distant future. We need to pray for them. This is a big change for them, isn't it? You and all of us know what it's like to move house. And now to move house under pressure of time, to sell one place and buy another and all the complications, we need to pray for them. The children to go to a new school, for Becca to start a new job, for Dave to start ministry among us. You know, it's demanding. Let's take Paul's point. Let's take on board what Paul is saying. He needed prayer, and we need prayer, all of us. If we are to live for Jesus, we are to be those who live because of the prayers of others, as well as our own prayer. So, living for Jesus. And so, Paul says, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. And he is really the big issue now, isn't it, for Paul? And he is speaking as someone who is willing to die for the Lord Jesus. It's an interesting thing, isn't it, that for Paul, living meant service for Christ, but dying was so much better, which is an odd sort of way of speaking if you think about it. In fact, to be honest, Paul does something here which he doesn't do very often, and that is he lets you and me into his thinking, into his inner mind. We go into a sort of soliloquy. Now, you know what a soliloquy is. Those of you who are very literate, you know that Shakespeare goes into soliloquies, you know. To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether it is nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune or to take arms against the sea of trouble and... I can't remember the next bit. It's impressive, though, wasn't it? Don't you think? I thought I did quite well there. That's a soliloquy. Only usually read better than that. And that's what Paul does. Listen, for to me, to live is Christ and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far, but it is more necessary for you, Philippians, that I remain in the body. Do you see what he's doing? He's letting us in to his thinking. And here's a man in conflict. He just can't make up his mind which is best. He wants to be the fruitful apostle that he's been for many years. He wants to go on serving his churches. He wants to go on evangelizing and bringing men and women into the kingdom of God. He's got this immense pressure in his heart to serve Christ for the church. But what is far better for Paul is to go to Christ, is to be with Christ for eternity. That Paul is just so anxious to see Jesus. You know, we've been going through many months where people have not seen their loved ones, have they? You know, people who've been abroad and their parents have been abroad, they've not been able to see them. Some who even live locally, they haven't been able to see. And the pleasure and the tremendous uplift of seeing those that we have not seen, whom we love, how we can embrace them, and they really fill our hearts with joy. And that is where Paul is with Jesus, who he cannot see now, but his heart is so bursting with love for his Savior that he cannot wait to pass through the door of death, not into darkness, but into the sunshine of Jesus Christ. He cannot wait to be in the presence of the Savior and the Lord that he loves so much, which is eternal joy. For me, to die is Christ. And of course, that's true for all God's people. It's not just the apostle. It's for all of God's children. And the situation is, it's not just that it's a positive thing in the sense of meeting with Jesus, but the negative side is Paul is going to leave behind all the stresses and the strain and the pain and the uncertainty of this life, as we will too. And he's going to leave behind, and we are going to leave behind when we meet with Jesus, we're going to leave behind all the sicknesses and the illnesses and the injuries that we all experience. We're going to leave behind, finally, that aging process, which is a strain to all of us. Some of you don't know that yet, but you will. And we will leave that behind. We will be new people in Jesus Christ, transformed by him. And the great thing is, we will leave behind all that sadness that consumes us all. That sense of loss, the sense of mourning which hurts every one of us and for some every day. That will all be gone when we meet in the beauty and the light of Jesus Christ. And these things won't be just a distant memory. There'll be no memory at all. They will be gone forever as we live in Christ Jesus. This is what Paul is looking forward to. And of course, Paul, this is imminent for Paul. He knows that tomorrow I may well be executed. To die is gain is a reality for Paul. This business of death is looming large. But of course, that's not the only thing that energized Paul. The thing that energized Paul was the coming of Christ again, that Jesus is coming again. And you'll know if you read Paul's letters, it is full of the coming of Christ and the glory of Christ when he comes and the transformation that will appear when Christ comes. In fact, the New Testament is just full of the coming of Jesus. Some 300 times in the New Testament, the coming of Christ is talked about and mentioned. That's, I'm told, once every 13 verses. It's as important as that. It is so dominant in Christian thinking as that. But the problem for you and me is, I wonder how dominant it is for us. It may be once every 13 verses in the New Testament, but maybe the thought of Christ coming and of our being with him perhaps only occurs once a week in our minds, or once a month, or maybe not at all. Because this world, we're full of it. It dominates us, doesn't it? It's everything. It's all around us. We have all the worries and the cares and the stresses and the responsibilities and the pleasures of this world. It's around us immediately, all the time. But that's not the way the New Testament treats these things. It says to you and me as Christians, we should contemplate continually the coming of Jesus and our being with him. This removes from us the fear of death, that we do not pass from darkness into eternal darkness, but from darkness into eternal light. And that we should contemplate the beauty of Christ and the looking forward. My friend, every bit of beauty that you see in this world, every pleasure that you may receive in this world is but an echo, just a shadow of the glory that is to come for God's people in eternity. So you love nature and look out on the world and you look at the nature of around you. That is a shadow, as beautiful as it may be, of what is to come. And this is what's driving Paul. For me to live is Christ. To die is gain. It's a gain. But then, not only is this dying for Christ, there is also a striving for Christ. As we said, going as a Christian is going uphill, and we know what that feels like, every one of us. And these Philippian Christians do. Paul's sort of conflict is because he really cares about them. And they're going through problems. I mean, in verse 23, he says, I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ. This is a burning desire in him, which is better by far. But it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your boasting in Christ Jesus will abound on account of me. His heart is for this church. We looked at that at the very first two verses of this letter. And so he's concerned for them that they would go on in the faith and deepen in the faith. But there's a reason, and that is because they're in trouble. Verse 29 at the end of our reading, for it has been granted to you, he says, on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him, since you are going through the same struggle you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. They are going through a struggle. They're going through persecution as Christians in this city of Philippi. So what are they to do? Here they are under pressure. You know, the early Christians were called atheists. That seems so strange to us, to our ears. But they were known as atheists. And the reason was is because they didn't believe in all the gods. They didn't believe in the Roman and the Greek gods. And they didn't go to the gods' temples that were littered everywhere in the Roman cities. So they were thought of as atheists. You don't believe what we believe. You don't believe in all these gods. And that's a dangerous thing. And not only that, they were people who didn't worship the emperor. He wasn't really their king. Jesus was. Jesus is their king. And they only bowed the knee to King Jesus. Well, you can immediately see how dangerous that would have been. It would have been seen as subversive. It would have been treachery. And so they were immediately under suspicion and, of course, under direct opposition and persecution. That is their situation. Now, that is rapidly heading our way. Don't misunderstand. Don't bury your head in the sand. That is heading our way. In the West. But what does Paul say to them? Well, he tells them how to behave. Whatever happens, he says in verse 27, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. In other words, be what you are. Live in Philippi, live wherever you happen to be living at the moment, as people of who you are. Live as those who are part of the kingdom of heaven. That's what you are. We sang about it earlier on in some of our songs. You are, if you are following Jesus Christ as Savior, a member of the kingdom of heaven. You are part of that kingdom. You are a child of God. Now, what you've got to do and what I've got to do is just live it. You don't have to strive to be what you are. You are that. So live as a member of the kingdom of heaven, of Christ's people, as a Christian. Just get on with it. That's what you must do. But Paul is a bit more specific than that. Then, whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in one spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel, without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. So he says three things about them. One is that they should be united as Christians. If you want to say anything to this world, then it's got to be done in a united fashion, that this church, any church, must be united in its love for each other and in its service to each other. That should be distinctive. I can't imagine in the Roman world that there was any sight of that anywhere other than in the church. The Roman world was run by power and by authority and status. But the Christian church wasn't like that. It was utterly countercultural. And so this unity of the body of Jesus Christ, as we say, is so vital to our witness. So united. In fact, it's interesting how the word one appears twice. You stand firm in the one spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel. So we are united as God's people in the Spirit of God. It is a Spirit-wrought glory. It is a Spirit-wrought grace, this unity of God's people. But then also as one to strive for the faith of the gospel. So they're not only united in their little holy huddle, but actually they're preaching the gospel as well in the marketplace and with their neighbors. It's dangerous, but you get on with it. They are preaching the gospel. And they're not frightened. Paul isn't afraid. And he's saying, don't you be afraid. Look, without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. That's a big call, isn't it? Don't be afraid. Get the gospel out there. Join together as a church. But don't let fear grip you. And the word there has a sort of metaphor element to it, which is of stampeding horses. Now, I don't like horses. I don't like one horse. I don't like a whole load of horses stampeding. But you see the image, you know, the Christians can get so wound up in fear that they like stampeding horses, going the wrong way, getting away from the danger. No. Don't be frightened in any way. But then you see it has a remarkable effect. Isn't it interesting how he puts it? This is a sign to them that they will be destroyed, but that you will be saved, and that by God. So here are these opposers, here are these persecutors, and they seem to have the upper hand. The Christians have no power. So they're victims of this persecution. But that's not the way Paul sees it. He turns it around. He says, look, don't be surprised. Don't misunderstand. When people persecute you, they may seem to have the upper hand, yes. But your witness as a united church with this powerful gospel and the fact that you're fearless, even in the face of death, undermines their view of things. It affects their conscience. They're not going to tell you that. But your Christian life, your Christian witness, will affect their conscience. And not only that, it will affect their view of life. You seem to have a different view of life. You're not troubled like they are. You're not afraid like they are. You're not forever seeking your own will like they are. And it begins to affect the fact that their life isn't like that. What's going on here? And the third thing, it begins to remind them that there is an eternity to face. That's what you're talking about. There is an eternity. And in that eternity, there are those who reject Christ who are doomed. There is a hell waiting for those who reject Christ upon this earth. That's what he says. It's a sign to them that they will be destroyed. And so you're affecting their conscience and the way they look at life and their philosophy, but also the way that they're looking at death. That death is not the end. And so Paul is encouraging these Christians to live for Jesus and not to be afraid to die for him. And so the call to us as a church is that as a united church, we hold out the gospel in this day and age in every way we can. That we do not fear. That's a big ask, isn't it? I doubt whether there's one of us who does not fear at some time in our lives. And sometimes fear just to tell people the gospel. No, no, don't fear, says Paul. There's no need to. Don't fear the future. Don't fear today. And don't certainly fear death. Because that's the entry to Jesus. But in the process, we need to pray for each other. If we want to live for Christ and die for Christ, then we must pray for each other. We must be a praying church, says Paul. Pray for each of us. Pray for every individual. Pray for those who lead. Pray for those who do whatever it is in the church. We need to pray for each other. For me to live is Christ. To die is gain, which is far better, says the Apostle Paul. May that shine in our lives, even this coming week, whatever God brings into our lives as the week progresses. May we be those people who live for Christ, but look forward to the glory that is to come. Well, we're going to sing. I noticed, actually, in one of our songs that the volume wasn't very high, and we all started mumbling. We're not used to hearing each other, are we? Sing, you know, we thought you were doing a solo. Well, I don't care if we are. We're going to sing now about the church rising up and putting our armor on. We are church militant on earth. That's what we are. Let's be those with God's help that we can be that. Let's stand to sing.
Our captain, for now the weak can say that they are strong in the strength that God has given. With shield of faith and belt of truth, we'll stand against the devil's lies. An army bold whose battle cry is love, reaching out to the captor, and with the sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor. When faced with trials on every side, we know the outcome is secure, and Christ will have the prize for which he died, and in heaven where love and mercy meet, as the Son of God is stricken, then see his foes lie crushed beneath his feet, for the conqueror has risen. And as the stone is rolled away, and Christ emerges from the grave, his victory march continues till the day, every eye and heart shall see him. So
forward to having our own music eventually, don't we? Anyone play the drums? It'd be good to have you, wouldn't it? Well, perhaps not. I don't know. It's a matter of opinion. Depends who's doing the drumming, really. Let's just pray. Lord our God, we are stirred by the words of the Apostle Paul. We know they're written by the Holy Spirit through that great apostle. His confidence leaves us astonished. His eagerness to serve the church, but also his incredible impatience to be with Christ. But he was writing, Lord, to people just like us, with all the pressures and the weaknesses that we have. And so we ask that you stir us up by the Spirit of God in all our weakness, that we may be those who live as those of the kingdom, praying for each other, that we may live for Christ, and that we may have our hearts stirred, looking forward to the day that we will be with our Jesus and be transformed by the sight of him. May that be true for each of us, Lord, even this coming week. In Jesus' name, amen.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still, still waters. His goodness restores my soul. And I will trust in you, and I will trust in you alone, for your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will my ways in righteousness, and he anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. I feast on his will trust in you, and I will trust.